good evening and welcome to Tinkering with Etkelar. For this episode, I have another piece of old-school computer hardware. Back in the 80s and early 90s, when you wanted accurate and high-quality hard copies of your technical drawings, printers just would not do. The sound of needles hitting ribbons was still around, and while laser printers and inkjets were starting to get useful, the resolution was still meh. The aspiring architect or product designer of the time just had to use an XY pen plotter. These were also useful for drawing on transparency film with special pens and get a one-to-one PCB layout for photo etching. The model I found on eBay last year reminded me of the one we had, again, during my apprenticeship. I recalled it being a nifty A4 plotter, and since it was cheap enough, I just hit buy now, without checking too much of the details. I just made sure it's the device, and not just the box. Imagine my surprise when it arrived, and I found out that this is the A3 version. Oops, this is quite a bit bigger. The seller did pack it up good, but the padding was a bit too hard. The plastic end caps took some damage in transit. Naturally, it's quite a bit of dirty in here too, so open it up and oh my god, what happened here? Ew! Looking at the damage, it seemed that the device suffered some water-related incident at some time. Yuck! That definitely needs deeper cleaning than anticipated. A complete disassembly is not just for fun, but mandatory in this case. Most of it came apart without any issue. The only thing that had me at the ready to just break it mark was one of the ferrite blocks on the cables. The big one and the tiny one came off normally. Remove the tape and prise them apart with mild force. But the medium one, I had to use brute force, which did knock off two little chips. And yes, I was wearing safety glasses for that operation. The stepper motors were also extremely gunked up on the outside, so I took them apart too. The inside was rather clean though. I put a bit of oil into the bearings. I didn't want to replace them, but they are shielded ones, so getting new grease in is not easy. Pen holders are assembled with these nasty one-way clips. And the pins are plastic, so no forcing them off. Dremel it is then. A good wash and rinse to get the gunk and what might be mold off from all the parts. Followed by some light overall sanding, just enough to get the rust off. I did apply some rust converter on the more extreme parts. Then I covered the inside, which might have been plated, with primer and gave the visible side some fresh coat of black paint. Not caring much about the overspray on the inside. Nobody is ever going to see that, right? I bet you all know what's coming up next. Recapping, yay! Oh, looks like these ones on the special board actually truly needed a recapping. There is some liquid gunk underneath and some of the pins around them have quite a bit of corrosion. Let's fix those. Did that wire just fall out on the other end? Yikes, that's a first for me. The corrosion seems to have eaten all the way through between the solder and the wire. Now I'm concerned for all the other joints too. Better reflow them all. And that led me to sanding off every pin and almost every pad on the board before putting the components back. That little secondary board might be something for Big Clive. It says, danger, high voltage. Why, you ask? Let's have a look at the mat that covers the paper area. which is glued down well and good. Oomph! That took more force than expected and left a sticky residue on both sides. Now you can see that there are two wires connected to the pad's underside. More to the point, connected to some tracks that might be graphite. These tracks are interleaved like two combs, and the wires connect to the high voltage output of that board. It is actually a static electricity generator. When powered on, the high voltage on the underside of the pad will cause the paper on top to stick to it. And now, reassembly. Starting off with the static pad, making sure that it's the same distance from all the corners as before. The middle part is still somewhat sticky from before. I couldn't get that off, and I didn't want to use too much force nor heavy chemicals to keep the carbon tracks intact. I just added a bit of double-sided tape around the edge and done. There's a plastic connector in the X-drive to extend the stepper axle to the other side. It is cut in the form of some universal joint to smooth out any deviation. But the plastic had cracked on one side. Adding a bit of epoxy and recutting the threads for the grub screws. Next part, all the stuff on the underside, the X stepper and belt assembly, including the springs to keep the belts tensioned. All of the open bearings for the rollers get new grease. They were quite stiff. Oh, and in case you're wondering, I left the aluminium parts without paint. That's why only some parts are painted. The Y-axis moves on the crossbeam. It holds the stepper motor and pen assembly. Here I noticed another damaged bit. The two pieces that hold the bearings are cracked and the pen unit was scratching along. I added a bit of epoxy and, with some heat, bent them slightly back. It did the trick and now the pen unit runs on the wheels again. The pen assembly was a bit fiddly. It contains the pen holder, which is moved up and down by a solenoid. That in turn has an adjustable spring to set soft or hard pen down mode. Now to remount the tracks for the X-axis. Tight fit. I should have put down the mat later, but it works. Adjusting all the wheels so that they ride on the rails without binding was also quite a bit of try, curse, repeat action. Switches for the initialization need to be exact enough so that the plotter will not ram into anything when it tries to move back home. So I made sure I put them into a position that made sense to me. And now, the moment of truth. I did not bother to pre-order a power brick for it, as I did not know what exactly it needs, besides 24 volts and maybe up to 1.5 amps. So I set my lab power supply to 24 volts and opted for a conservative setting of point something amps. Power on. Woohoo! It homes into the limit switches. I can also control it with the cursor keys. drying out the paper holder next. Success! Wow, that paper can be peeled off, of course, but it's not sliding anywhere while that thing is on. Nice! That and the fact that I did not get shocked means the high voltage part is working properly. For the broken parts in the case, I use epoxy again. But eventually, these will need a good round of retrobrite and a bit of plastic filler. Still, complete and solid is good enough for now. Now, the pens are a completely different beast. The 8 ball pen pens it comes with are completely dried up. They were stored without the cap in the holders, it seems. I found out that the backside is not just a covered sticker, but rather a cap that comes out, so I'm soaking them in some alcohol and maybe we'll try some marker refills later. But not all will recover, some tips are missing the ball even. Thankfully, the seller did provide a pack of spare pens, felt tip ones, and while there's only 4 colors of those, at least they are still in working order. So, the good news, all is ready for a real test drive. The bad news, there is no driver for this anywhere at all. The good news, it is HPGL compatible with a standard RS-232 port. The bad news, all configuration is done with a set of 16 DIP switches and the documentation is nowhere to be found. I made a note of the original DIP positions and started connecting the device to a USB to serial adapter with the standard modem cable I had around. Sending commands with a terminal program did nothing at all, no matter what settings for the port I tried. I got desperate and created a plot file in KiCAD. It sure looks like a standard HPGL file. Setting the port to a reasonable 9600 8N1 configuration and sending the file over. Oh, it moves and starts to do something, but not at all resembling the drawing. Troubleshooting it is then. After putting down some paper and adding a working pen into the mix, I saw that it scribbled some tiny pieces that looked coherent. I can see a tiny 4 in that mess under a magnification lens. So it seems to be getting some correct data, but not all. I measured the serial data signals, tried different settings for parity and stop bits, nothing. Eventually, I found the device uses the DSR signal for handshake. It signals buffer full, and for some reason that line was connected to the same output signal on the PC side of my cable. After looking over quite a few specs and some more measuring, I connected it to the CTS input to enable hardware flow control. But it still didn't plot correctly. Different now, and the data stream stopped whenever the plotter had enough. But still, it almost looked like it did a reset ever so often, like crashing or doing a power cycle. There it was. Just about half a second after the pen solenoid came on, my lab power supply went into the current limiting mode for a fraction of a second. Too fast to see unless you paid close attention, and that dip in voltage caused the plotter to reset. So, bumping up the limit to over 1 amp then, and lo and behold, it plots. Two errors to kind of complement each other. Closing up the last few screws and adding a new set of rubber feet because the old ones were deteriorating. And now, a final test plot. This concludes this episode. I will eventually take care of the case and try some options for the pens, but overall I'm happy that it works. Thanks for joining, and I hope you enjoyed this episode. See you next time! The two pieces that hold the bearings are cracked, and the pen unit was scratching along. I added a bead of epoxy. What's a bead?